Well, it is a great pleasure to introduce a friend and just someone who is one of my heroes in the intellectual community, Robin D.G. Kelley. He's professor of African American Studies and Anthropology at Columbia University, and he is a guiding force in the Institute for Research in African American Studies at Columbia. He's also a professor of history and Africana studies at NYU. I haven't figured out how you're still all those things, but before coming to New York University in 1994, he taught at Emory University in the late 1980s and the University of Michigan between 1990 and 1994. Professor Kelley did his undergraduate work at California State University, Long Beach, and received his PhD and master's from the University of California, Los Angeles. Robin Kelley is the author of 7 books and over 100 articles. His writings cover a wide array of subjects, including music, civil rights, labor, black internationalism, and can be found in academic journals such as the African Studies Review, Kalalu Social Text, and the Journal of American History, as well as popular publications such as the New York Times, The Nation, and Rolling Stone. He is a prolific writer and a brilliant thinker. He has written several prize-winning books. His book, Hammer and Hoe, published in 1990, won prizes from the Organization of American Historians, the Southern Historical Association, and the Gustavus Myers Center for the Study of Human Rights in the United States. Indeed, the Gustavus Myers Center has awarded him 3 book prizes. He's won for Hammer and Hoe. He's also won for Your Mama's Dysfunctional, Fighting the Culture Wars in Urban America, which he published in 1997. And he also won the Outstanding Book Award for To Make Our World Anew, which he edited with Earl Lewis. Kelley's book, Race Rebels, Culture, Politics, and the Black Working Class, 1994, was acclaimed outstanding book by the National Conference of Black Political Scientists. Time doesn't permit me to enumerate all of his books, but most recently he's published Freedom Dreams, The Black Radical Imagination, which came out in 2002, and he's currently working on a book on Thelonious Monk and also writing a history of African Americans with his co-authors Earl Lewis and Tara Hunter. Professor Kelley has received numerous honors and fellowships. He received the Distinguished Alumni Award from Cal State, Long Beach. He's been a Montgomery Fellow at Dartmouth College in 2000 and 2002, the Robert Hess Scholar in Residence at Brooklyn College 2002, a Schomburg Scholars in Residence Fellow in 2000 and 2001, and a Fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in the Behavioral Sciences at Stanford in 1997 and 1998. I've had the pleasure of knowing Professor Kelley for well over a decade now, and what impresses me about him is his combination of passion and intellectual rigor. He brings this combination to the subjects of his scholarship. And more than any scholar I know, he is attentive to the fullness of the humanity of ordinary African American men and women, working people, sharecroppers, the poor. Kelley rescues them from obscurity with erudition and eloquence. He takes their ideological contribution to larger social movements seriously. He examines and discloses their hidden forms of resistance. He revels in their cultural authority and creativity. He speaks of their poetics of struggle. He offers his perspective on history when he writes in Freedom Dreams, and I'd like to quote him. Knowing the color of the sky is far more important than counting clouds. Or to put it another way, the most radical art is not protest art, but works that take us to another place, envision a different way of seeing, perhaps a different way of feeling. I'd like to say that those qualities are Robin Kelley's qualities, and that's been his influence in academia. Because of his vision, he has shown us the past, he has critiqued the present in such a way that gives us a new way of seeing and feeling. He is imagination. He is vision. He sheds the ecstatic. These are all the things he values. And he teaches us a poetics of struggle. For this, we will be eternally grateful. And we thank you, Robin, for the dignity of your work and in your expression of African Americans' dignity in just their sheer struggle for survival. Thank you.
I feel like I'm gonna cry. That's so nice. And you know, everyone who knows me knows that I'm not good at taking any kind of compliments. I'm like, don't say anything. So it's embarrassing to me, but thank you. So especially from Evelyn, whose Righteous Discontent is a model for writing history for me, and I've been trying really hard to write a book that good. And one of these days, one day I'm gonna make it. But it's just a brilliant, amazing thing. And also, Evelyn is also a patron of the arts in that she's bought Deirdre Harris Kelley's original works. So thank you very much. I know she has more work for sale, you know. So in any case, thanks again for giving me this opportunity. And this time I'm going to actually thank some people. I know I was in a rush yesterday and I'm still in a rush, but let me thank a few people. First of all, thank Del Hamilton for all the work that she's done on this. And I'm the most disorganized person in the world, so luckily she takes care of all the things that I can take care of. Oh, okay. Yeah, and I try, you know, I know you deal with divas, and I try not to be one, you know, but thank you. Maxine Gordon, who's here, thank you so much. She's like a great friend who's been pushing me along the way on this music. And is herself writing what's going to be a brilliant dissertation on bebop and about her late husband by the name of Dexter, you know. And you know her last name is Gordon, so you know who that is. Herbie Miller, who's not here, he, at the last minute, loaned me a copy of one of the rare Guy Warren records I've been trying to track down. So thank you, Herbie, even though you can't be here. Farrah Griffin is not here. She has a terrible eye infection, so she couldn't make it. But Farrah, who's my colleague at Columbia, and a great friend, convinced me to do this. At the last minute, I was going to like pull out and or try to do something totally different. But she says, "Oh yeah, you know, it doesn't matter if all these amazing people are doing scholarship that's related to this. Don't be afraid." I said, "Okay." So she gave me the confidence. And quickly, Neil Clark, who really helped me on some of the research on the issues I'm going to talk about this evening. He's a wonderful scholar himself, but he's also the drummer for Randy Weston's band, his African Rhythms band. Danny Dawson, another brilliant scholar who couldn't be here, but he's someone who just knows so much about this material and really has directed me. And finally, the person who had to deal with my craziness, who's also not here, is Deirdre Harris Kelley. She's an amazingly patient person, and I'm surprised she hasn't divorced me yet. But I don't know what that's about. We'll figure it out. But she really helped me think through some of this stuff, and also she did some of the scanning for me, like late hours of the night when I'm trying to get this stuff together. So thank you, Deirdre. You know, you're not here. Okay, Drum Wars, Africa Speaks, America Answers. On October 19th, 1962, Time Magazine ran this editorial, unauthored editorial, about jazz and the new black nationalism titled Crow Jim. Okay, that's the name of the article, Crow Jim. The piece described, quote, angry young men who are passionately involved in the rise of Negro nationalism. Jazz compositions these days bear titles like A Message from Kenya, Art Blakey, Uhuru Africa, Randy Weston, Africa Speaks, America Answers, Guy Warren, Afro-American Sketches, Oliver Nelson, Max Roach's Freedom Now Suite, We Insist, includes tunes like Tears for Johannesburg, a lament for the Africans shot down in the Sharpeville Massacre, end quote. Now the piece, this editorial implied that all the people mentioned were African American, but the author was mistaken. One, Guy Warren, was from Ghana, and he was especially indignant at being grouped together with these particular artists. In a long but unpublished letter to the editor, Warren distanced himself from other musicians, from these other musicians, and insisted that his album, Africa Speaks, America Answers, in no way represents these politics, and he distanced himself, you know, completely. What's more, he takes them to task for jumping on the, quote, African bandwagon, and he credits himself with bringing African music to American jazz. He talked about how he had introduced African rhythms when no one was interested. Then, quote, and this is Guy Warren speaking in his letter, the miracle happened. Africa began to stir from her deep sleep and to stretch out her strong hands. The black giant was ready to take her place in world affairs. The flame of freedom began to burn through everything and anything that stood in its way. Suddenly, Africa became the thing. It became the gimmick in the trade, he continued, and every SOB jumped on the bandwagon to make money. In America, that is the supreme thing, how to make money and make it fast. So Max Roach, Art Blakey, and many other musicians started to play their so-called African music and to give such aggressive titles to their music, end quote. So he went so far as to suggest that what they played was indeed a manifestation of reverse racism, hence the term Crow Jim, though he acknowledged also that it was a product of years and years of oppression. Nevertheless, the music in question was, in his words, racial and prejudicial. Quote, the so-called African music which these musicians and others play sounds very hollow and meaningless to me. And whatever you want to call it, in Warren's view, it is not African music. Now, in some respects, Warren's remarks are self-serving. A Ghanaian-born drummer committed to fusing jazz and African rhythms, what he deemed jazz, J-A-A-Z-Z, that was his own construction. Warren had spent the previous 7 years struggling for recognition and fighting to get his music produced. By 1962, he found himself competing in an overcrowded field. On the other hand, there is some truth to his statement, not to his dismissal of these artists' work, but rather to his understanding of the market. Africa indeed had become the thing, and record companies were searching for the right authentic body to promote the new wave of African music. In 1960, Columbia Records found their man in Michael Babatunde Olatunji. Olatunji is credited often as being the first musician to create authentic African drum music in the United States. Now, as far as Warren was concerned, Olatunji was even more of a hustler than those African-American musicians who were creating faux African music. Throughout his memoir, which is titled I Have a Story to Tell, published in 1962 in Ghana, Warren referred to Olatunji as a traitor to Africa and a complete fraud. And he told one interviewer, quote, people think that just because you come from Africa, you can play drums, that whatever you play is right. No siree. I mean, just because you come from America, it doesn't mean to say that you can play baseball. Okay. Now, how did this happen?
Let me just get this,
if you don't mind. Almost shocked myself to death, but it's okay, because I didn't, and life goes on, and it is a good life, because Harvard University is an amazing place, and the people here are so nice to me, I can't believe it. I have to take notes. Okay, in any case, so how did this happen? What sparked such an intense reaction on the part of Warren, not only to Olatunji, but to the entire explosion of what we might call neo-African jazz? See, this is why this sister got it together. It's like, it doesn't matter. You know, see, if I were a pianist and I started to sweat, she'd wipe my brow. You know what I'm saying? Before the sweat comes off my head. I tell you, you're amazing. Thank you so much. Yeah. She needs a raise. Okay. Anyway, and how is it that Warren, who made his first LP in 1955, fusing African music and jazz, was practically ignored and is still ignored by historians? How has he contributed to and shaped this transnational dialogue between jazz and West African musicians? Now, by revisiting Guy Warren's life and work, as well as the group of African-American drummers in this period who also contributed to incorporating African percussion and jazz, I hope to shed some light on these and other questions, in particular the perennial question of who is an authentic African drummer. Now, obviously, scholars in fields like ethnomusicology have methods of determining the authenticity of certain musical practices. I am not equipped to do this, nor am I not only not equipped, but I'm not really interested in trying to find out who among these drummers are playing purely traditional music. I think it's a quest worth exploring, and I think someone ought to do it. Besides, these artists are often explicit about the fact that they really weren't creating traditional music. They weren't drawing on tradition, but rather, too, they, too, were experimentalists and modernists trying to push their music in new directions. In an age when Africa is the thing, experimentalism can turn out to be a liability, as we'll see. Now, as I mentioned briefly yesterday, there were precedents to the explosion of interest in African drums besides the Afro-Cuban presence. And the reality that the African drum had not disappeared in the U.S., in fact, before or after Congo Square, is a story that will be told in a forthcoming book by Neil Clark, which is something to look for, he's working on. Anyway, in the 1930s at least, the dancer, choreographer, and drummer, Assadada Defora, had introduced African music and dance to the U.S. Born in Sierra Leone in 1890, in fact, his great-great-grandfather was a slave from Nova Scotia, which is an interesting connection. He had training as an opera singer. His mother was a renowned concert pianist trained in Europe. And he traveled first as a singer and then became interested in dance and choreography, promoting African dance around the world. In 1929, he moves to Harlem, and 5 years later begins producing a series of dance dramas using African and African-American dancers. Some of his better-known productions were Zunguru in 1940 and Batanga in 1941. And these introduce, again, African dance and music to fairly elite audiences in the United States. Now, some of DeFore's work was staged by the African Academy of Arts and Research, founded by Kingsley Ozwambo Mbandiwe. The African Academy organized annual festivals beginning in 1942, showcasing African music and dance. Its second festival in 1943, titled African Dances and Modern Rhythms, not only brought together music and dance from Brazil, Trinidad, Haiti, and Cuba, but included American jazz with performances by Marilee Williams and dance by Bill Robinson. And that particular performance was attended by Eleanor Roosevelt, just to show you how popular it really was. Other dancers and choreographers followed suit, notably Catherine Dunham and Pearl Primus, who drew on dance forms from the whole African diaspora in addition to Africa. In addition, Pearl Primus's drummer, Moses Mianz, was a Nigerian who has been credited by several early African-American drummers, including Chief Bey, with introducing the Ashiko drum to the United States, okay, in the early 40s. Another factor, though not directly from Africa, was a Haitian drummer, Tiroro, who became quite a sensation in the 1940s. We should also acknowledge the role of various ethnographic recordings of African music, which received significant distribution among popular record buyers in the early period in the 40s. Some of the earliest were made by Thurston Knudsen and Augie Goupil, beginning in 1941. Here's an example of African drums. Now, he and his friends, collected percussion instruments from around the world, from the Pacific Islands, Africa, Latin America, and they learn how to play them by observing or studying with master musicians, and then they come home to the United States and make these records, these recordings of what they heard by playing them themselves. And they were very precise about the kinds of rhythms they were playing and their origins, and explaining the specific names and uses of the instruments. On the other hand, it's kind of hard to take them too seriously. In the liner notes to Knudsen's album, Primitive Percussion, which you should see, this one, he explains that the bata and ngoma drums they were using come from, quote, the exotic milieu of the world-famous Don the Beachcomber restaurant in Hollywood. You know, these are all collectors, you know. Now, the most important and most serious of these ethnographic recordings was Harold Corlander's two LP collection, African and Afro-American Drums, which was put out by Ethnic Folkways. The first LP included field recordings from Rwanda, Nigeria, the Yoruba, Congo, South Africa, Madagascar, among other places. And then the second LP extends to the diaspora with drummers and singers from Cuba, Bahamas, Haiti, Brazil, Jamaica, Suriname, Virgin Islands, and the United States. Now, the important point here is that this particular record was in circulation in the early to mid-50s, and it followed a bunch of other ethnographic African LPs put out by Ethnic Folkways. Now, the popularity of these recordings was fueled by a general public fascination with Africa in the 1950s. We find an increasing number of articles in the mainstream press about Africans in the U.S., especially about students sojourning here who supposedly embody the modern and the primitive. So in 1955, for example, the New York Times ran a story about a Ghanaian student named Eric G.K. Ajorolo, who was about to receive a master's degree in journalism from Columbia University. The article made a special point of describing his appearance on the show called Newsarama, the journalism school's weekly television program, and the writer says, quote, "Dressed in native garb, he beat out messages on a pair of African talking drums. He learned the technique of sending messages through the jungle as a child." Well, as if there's a jungle in Ghana, but that's really interesting. But again, he's supposed to be like playing on the idea of telling the news with the talking drum. Now, finally, one of the main pioneers introducing African rhythms and jazz, again, after Dizzy Gillespie and Chano Pozo's collaborations, of course, was Art Blakey. 2 years before Guy Warren arrived here, Blakey made a recording with Puerto Rican percussionist Sabu Martinez on Horace Silver's trio album in 1953, titled Message from Kenya. Now, the reference is obviously to the uprising of the Kikuyu Land and Freedom Army in Kenya, known as the Mau Mau Rebellion. The piece, though, has no apparent relationship at all to Kenya or East Africa. Rather, it is based, he reported that it was based on a story told to him by the Nigerian drummer Moses Mianz, who I mentioned before, Pro Primus's drummer, about a hunter whose, quote, cries celebrate the news that he has captured more game than any other hunter in the village in order to convince the girl he loves of his prowess. Okay, now fast forward to 1957. Blakey records his famous solo drum piece titled Ritual and includes a spoken preface, a two-minute preface, where he tells the exact same story, okay? But this time, he says he learned it directly from the Ijaw people during a two-year stay in Nigeria in 1947-48. He makes no mention of Mianz, who had actually been in the United States since the early 40s and who had just happened to be Ijaw, okay? So follow me here. And moreover, this was the first public mention of his trip to Africa, which, as Ingrid Monson points out in her article, it couldn't have been 2 years. It couldn't have been more than a year. And it couldn't have been 48. It had to have been 46 to early 47. In any case, what he ends up playing on Message from Kenya has more than a passing resemblance to what he plays in Ritual. And what I want to do is just play little segments, first of A Message from Kenya, and then a segment from Ritual. By the way, the sound system in this room broke down, so we don't have like really good sound, so bear with me if it's not strong. Let's see what we got here. This should do it. Okay, now this is Ritual 4 years later. Same story. Okay, my own theory really has a lot to do, and I can't prove this yet, but it begins to make me really question about his trip to Africa. It, you know, And the fact that Moses Myon gets wiped out of the story, and the fact that in 1957, at the, you know, just weeks before the independence of Ghana, it carries more authenticity if you learn this from the Ijaw people themselves, you know, than it does an Ijaw who's in the United States in New York, you see. In any case, let's get to Guy Warren. This is my man. Okay, when Guy Warren arrived in Chicago from Ghana in late 1954, ready to make his mark on the jazz world, this is what the public landscape of African music looked like, what I just laid out for you. As far as Warren was concerned, none of it was authentic or even interesting, and he was never impressed with what Art Blakey was doing, for example. He says, quote, told an interviewer, quote, "Art Blakey bores me to death." Okay. He excites you at first, the first 2 seconds, and then that's it. He can't go any further than that. Now, Warren has never been short on opinions or confidence, as we'll see. Born on May 4th, 1923, in Accra, to an unmarried teenage mother, Warren's father was a well-known educator who ran a primary school for most of his life, but would not acknowledge his son's existence. Guy fell in love with jazz as a small child, hanging out in a local bar where lots of seamen from all over came in. At the government school, he began to learn drums formally and rose to drum major in the school band. He even began to work professionally in 1938. He was still only 15 years old. He became the drummer for the Accra Rhythmic Orchestra. He also landed a role as a dancer and comedian in a local production, which won him a scholarship at Achimota College. Sometime around 1943 or 44, he traveled to the U.S. There are two stories about his trip to the U.S. I'm not sure which one is true, but one is that he was recruited by U.S. military intelligence and worked briefly in Chicago and there discovered the jazz community. The second is that he decided to go to America during his last year of college, and he traveled to South America, Lima, Peru, Veracruz, Key West, Florida, and finally New Jersey and New York City. And there he adopted a pseudonym and supposedly played with several jazz bands as a drummer and vocalist. By his own account, he played with Miff Mole, but as far as I know, Miff Mole never had a black drummer in the 40s. So he might have been passing, but that's not possible, as you could see from his photograph. In any case, he returned and became a journalist for several Ghanaian papers, and he continued playing music. In 1947, he joined the popular highlife band, the Tempos, which was then under the leadership of Joe Kelley and later E.T. Mensa. They played most of the gigs for white audiences at the European Club in Accra. And it was there in 1948 that Warren got into a fight with a white man who called him an American nigger. Okay? And he says, quote, "I thrashed his ass out." You see, this was a sort of club where Africans were only seen padding about gently, dressed in white tunics, and here I come beating this guy up. It was a sensation. Just about the same time the Convention People's Party was forming, and I was the editor of a daily. Now, after the fight, Guy went to England and played with Kenny Graham and the Afro-Cubists for about 9 months, and he returned with all kinds of new ideas. He says, "When I came back from London, I brought the bongos and Cuban percussion to Ghana for the first time." Now, he also hung out at a Caribbean club in London and learned calypso music, played calypso and jazz records on a radio show that he hosted for the BBC, and he was really struck by the similarities between calypso and highlife. When he returned to Ghana in 1951, he began introducing these records and instrumentation to local musicians, and he also appeared briefly in a movie called The Boy Kumasenu in 1951. And in fact, I have a clip from that film, which I'm going to show at the end of this. So if you stick around, you could actually see it. If not, then you'll miss it. But it's a very interesting moment where he's doing this dance, and I'll give you some background on that. But in any case, jazz was his first love. And his dream was to introduce the Bintin Obonu, or talking drum, to jazz. So he decided to go to America. Now, as soon as Warren arrived in Chicago, in this period, end of 54, he went straight to Downbeat magazine offices in search of gigs. And through the editor, Jack Tracy, he hooked up with trumpet player vibist Gene Esposito and his jazz Latin group, which was made up almost entirely of Italian and Jewish musicians. Okay? Now, the pay was low, he scuffled to survive, but Esposito and Warren hit it off musically. Warren, however, was frustrated with the audiences and the clubs. Some clubs, for example, wouldn't hire the band because of Warren's race, so they would get gigs and Warren couldn't play. He was also frustrated with the constant demands for Afro-Cuban rhythms, okay? And he says, quote, "In those days, unless you played something very Cubanish in your jazz, nothing was happening. Anything contrary was queer, strange." Nevertheless, he was able to record his first album within months of his arrival. He arranged it through drummer Red Saunders, whom he had met through Dan Burley and Herb Nipson at Ebony Magazine. And this is a picture of Red Saunders is the one sitting at the drum set, you know. I can't tell you who else is in that picture. I haven't been able to do the research to do that. But this is a group of all Chicago musicians. Now, Saunders had a lot of contacts and secured a record deal with Decca. He agreed to do it as long as he played a major role in both the band and the organization of the music. The result, of course, was Africa Speaks, America Answers. With Guy Saunders working with the Gene Esposito band. It was an amazing album for many reasons. For one thing, as the first jazz African music fusion album, the band was all white, okay? Which is something that you don't expect given the politics of the time and what it represents, except for Warren and Saunders. And what's interesting, remember that Warren's LP gets thrown into this category of Crow Jim. You know, another example of reverse discrimination. He's got an all-white band, you know, basically doing this African music, which is so interesting the way it was read. Secondly, it was the album was made up entirely of original compositions by Warren that did more than fuse traditional African music and jazz. It also drew on popular dance rhythms, high life, and classical music, thus defying inherited categories. And like the music we talked about yesterday, Randy Weston and Ahmed Abdul-Malik's music, it had a very strong sacred dimension. In particular, songs such as Africa Speaks, or Ode to a Stream, or Eyi Waladong, which he translates as My Thanks to God, Chant, and Invocation to the Horned Viper, are either based on traditional sacred music or convey spiritual religious themes. Indeed, I think that the musicians who were initially drawn to Warren, Randy Weston being one of them, found the sacred elements in his music attractive, and the fact that he was a real African from the continent only enhanced the spiritual cachet. And yet, Warren did not practice any West African religion, nor was he a Muslim, nor was he a Christian, despite his frequent use of both Islamic and Christian themes in his music. Warren was a practicing Buddhist. Okay? Now dig that. In any case, what I want us to listen to first is Chant, which is a narrative piece set in West African village. And just to set it up, I mean, the way he tells the story, the chief is dead, and the royal drummer, in this case Warren, uses the Bintin Obonu to convey the message to everyone and to assemble the warriors for customary funeral rites. After they gather, Warren plays the talking drum again to perform the drum ritual, which accompanies the dead body. And then halfway through, he's joined by the piano and sax, which I don't think we're going to hear. What he, the royal drummer, Warren, is saying is, quote, "Hear ye, hear ye." And the musicians and warriors respond, "We hear." And the drummer says, "We have, as one man with one voice, done our duty to the chief." And then the warriors, meaning the rest of the band members, answer, "We have." And then Warren says, "Peace to the chief." And the answer is, "Peace, peace." So this is Chant.
Amen.
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 Yeah.
So keep in mind, that's a chorus that includes people like Tony Napanelli and Johnny Frigo, who are responding. Now, perhaps the most interesting piece for me is called Jazz As I See It, J-A-I-S-I. And it begins with Red Saunders playing the classic swing rhythm, almost like Papa Joe Jones, except for he uses a sax cymbal. The piano comes in playing dotted 16th notes, this dotted 16th note figure, and then Warren sings and is playing the congas. And then there's hand clapping on the one, which is interesting because a lot of people think of, you know, the pulse being on a two and four. But this is, you know, according to Warren and others, you know, hand clapping on the one is like a West African a rhythmic practice. Then you hear this bass pedal point in D, which is a drone, and then it swings like really hard in D minor, and you play this pentatonic scale over it. So what we're going to hear is just the beginning of Jazz As I See It. The soloist of Gene Esposito on trumpet, and then Ronnie Colbert comes in on baritone, and then back to Gene again and Ronnie, and then just a couple minutes of the song. But it's really, really interesting. Again, this is 1955. And that's Jazz As I See It. Now, according to Warren, this album was the first one to introduce high life in the United States. And as far as I know, I think he's right about this. He includes three high life songs, including a song called The High Life, which has some really corny lyrics, which, you know, you could read those. I'm not going to play the song, but it begins with the spoken invocation called From West Africa, the Land of Rhythm, We Bring You the High Life, and they sing. It's both Gene Esposito and Guy Warren. But musically, the more interesting High Life song is called Monkeys and Butterflies. And here the soloists are Gene, Ronnie Colbert, and LaMonica. And I just want you to hear this and think about who it might sound like. I was playing this at my house one day, and someone said, oh, I never heard fella like that, you know? But this is 1955, you know, and you think about people like Fela Kuti and, you know, the relationship between all this music. In any case, finally, Warren had ambitions to merge classical music with jazz to create a new art music. He included here a song called My Minuet, which is a very traditional waltz with a conga and sax cymbal underneath, played as if Bach had written it. And the most interesting piece, again, is a piece called Ode to a Stream, and the music is a narrative that's supposed to tell the story of the journey of a stream down a hill to its destination. It's a beautiful violin solo by Johnny Frigo, which we won't hear. And then Guy Warren actually, he's playing rhythm, but he also overdubs himself plucking strings on the piano to create a melodic line, which then is repeated by Gene Esposito on vibes. And the watery effect is created by brushes on cymbals. So this is an Ode to a Stream. Okay. Now, following the release of his first album, Warren set out to promote it and himself. He even floated press releases to various papers in Ghana, which I believe he wrote himself. He did say in an interview that he took care of his own press. So to give an example, the Accra Daily Graphic in December 28, 1956, ran an unsigned article reporting on a concert at DePaul, you know, in Chicago, where Warren allegedly, quote, outplayed and outshined Candido, the acclaimed king of the conga and bongo drums from Cuba. And the piece closed with the following. It looks like Guy is now assured a place in America's Jazz Hall of Fame. Musicians and fans alike think he is now the greatest and newest drummer to come along since Max Roach and Kenny Clarke and Art Blakey, the three kings of the jazz drums. And now who's the correspondent in the United States following Ghana, following Guy around at these concerts? It's Guy himself, see? Now, after nearly 2 years in Chicago, Warren decided to try his fortunes in New York City, and the timing seemed just right. I mean, partly because of commercial considerations that I talked about earlier, you know, the popularity of African music, and also Afro-Caribbean music, particularly Calypso was hot. Remember, Harry Belafonte sells a million copies of his LP, Calypso, which is unheard of, you know. So that's part of the context. Now, Warren immediately gets a job playing at the African Room, where African music, Calypso, and Afro-Cuban music was featured. And the fact that such a venue existed, and there were two in New York. There was the African Room West, which is on 7th Avenue and 44th Street, the African Room East on 3rd Avenue, and he played at the African Room East. But the fact that these exist is further indication of the growing popularity of African and African-based musics. But it also meant that the music was highly commercialized and marketed in a manner that played on stereotypes. So on the night of his first performance, when he appeared in traditional African clothes, in a blue velvet cap, African cap, the owner of the club, Harold Cantor, wanted him to change into the regular outfit that everyone else was wearing. That is, a torn-off, half-sleeved, collarless white shirt, raggedy black pants rolled up halfway up the legs, and a tattered straw hat, and no shoes, okay? And the style was supposed to represent the Caribbean, but Warren refused, and Cantor relented, so he ended up wearing his own outfit. Now, at the African Room, Warren met many of the leading percussionists, both Latino and African-American, and among them was a man named James Hawthorne Bay, or Chief Bay, whom Warren called General Lefty. that's Chief Bey there. Chief Bey grew up in New York City, across the street from Abyssinian Baptist Church. He was taught drums by a woman named Ismay Andrews from Philadelphia. Okay, and this is significant too, because of course people think of the drums as strictly a masculine activity in the U.S., and there's more to the story, which again Neil Clark and others will talk about when he writes this book. But you know, Ismay Andrews taught African dance classes at the church across the street, and they also studied with Moses Myans, who had been playing with Catherine Dunham and Pearl Primus. So by the time he met Warren, Chief Bey was already an accomplished drummer. Impressed with Bey, Warren hired him for his next album, recorded in 1958, called Guy Warren Sounds, Themes for African Drums, released by RCA Victor. And remember, RCA Victor, if you were here yesterday, is the label that released Ahmed Abdul-Malik's record around the same time. In any case, this is Guy Warren Sounds. By the way, in the picture, that's not Guy Warren. That's just some fake. In fact, I didn't even think it was a real person. I thought it was a statue, but my wife is convinced it's a real human being. Because it looks so plastic. And that's a bad image. I don't blame her for that. I blame myself. In any case, I paid a lot of money for that record, I'll tell you. So I just had to sit up there for a while. So Warren had conceived of the music for this album for drums and trombone. And he wanted Lawrence Brown of Ellington's band to play. And in fact, Warren had played with Duke Ellington briefly in Chicago. And he writes about it in his memoirs about how, you know, neither Duke Ellington nor Billy Strayhorn could really get into his music. And he was really disappointed, and Strayhorn doesn't know anything, and all this other stuff. But initially, Warren had tried to track down Lawrence Brown. He failed, so he got his producer, Nat Shapiro, to put him in touch with a trombonist, and he got a trombonist named Al Cinder. Turned out to be a disaster. Warren called him an idiot, despite the fact he had Juilliard training. He said he couldn't play his music after 12 rehearsals, but his son went on to play basketball. Yeah, you know, Lou Al Cinder, for those of you who don't know, Kareem. He used to go to my uncle's record shop on Amsterdam in 157 when he was in high school at Power High School, and come in there all 7 feet and buy jazz records. I saw with my own eyes when I was back in the back learning judo. So that's another story. In any case, Warren persisted. He did get Lawrence Brown on the date, along with Chief Bey and Robert Whitney and Philip Hepburn on drums. And he got bassist James Stiles and vibraphonist Earl Griffith to play on one track. All the rest are percussion with horn interventions. Once again, all the music was original, including the song that would become his best-known composition called Love, the Mystery Of, which was written for a dance performance at the African Room. And in fact, Warren said it, quote, portrays a youth and a maid brought together for the first time by that mysterious force of love, end quote. And it was originally performed by John Lay, of former Dunham dancer, and Gene Neal, whom he said inspired the song. It opens with solo trombone by Lawrence Brown, and otherwise the rest of his drums, percussion, and voice. A particularly fascinating piece, which I'm going to play, is called The Talking Drum Looks Ahead, which tries to fulfill his dream of introducing the talking drum to jazz as another tonal instrument. Now, we know that it's a tonal instrument already, but to treat it as such, and not just as a rhythmic, although all instruments are rhythmic instruments, but really as a tonal one as well. So he plays a melodic jazz line on the talking drum over blues changes, and he dedicates the song to, quote, my idol, Thelonious Monk, who's mine, too. Thank you. Now, whether you call it the Obono Bintu or you call it the Dundun drum, whatever it is, the talking drum is so interesting because it is meant to reproduce the tonal system of language. So he's got all kinds of puns going on here, which I can't understand because I can't speak the language. So he's both playing a tonal instrument along with the harmonic foundations of the 12-bar, you know, three-chord blues, but he's also speaking. And so there's all kinds of things going on there which deserve greater investigation. In any case, another song, Lady Marie Drum Suite, Part 2, was a source of a conflict between Warren and Max Roach, which he talks about in his memoir. Max Roach was at his house with Willie Jones when he played a recording of it, and he simply didn't believe that Warren played the whole piece by himself on a drum set. And they had this big fight and falling out, and I won't go into that because I don't have much time, but it's a real virtuoso performance. What you hear, too, is that Guy overdubbed the bamboo flute, which he's playing, and the voice, but the drums, he's playing all this on a standard drum set. Okay, so this is a Lady Marie Drum Suite. This is a little snippet of it. And that piece, by the way, is in two parts. It's about 12 minutes altogether, which is, you know, to have a 12-minute drum piece on any album in the 1950s is already unusual and not very good in terms of marketing. But this is a virtuoso performance, really. I mean, he's really doing amazing things right there, and you just wonder how he became obscure, which we'll talk about in a second. By the way, we got started really late, so it's not as late as you think it is, just so you know. I'm not... Anyway, let me continue. He also recorded an autobiographical track, My Story, which is about his childhood. And the lyrics say it all. He says, quote, my mother is dead. I have not even a father. Nevertheless, I will play my drums and dance always, for such is my solace. It's a very long piece, mostly percussion and voice. And he employs Lawrence Brown's trombone as his inner voice, one that comforts and keeps him on an even keel. Now, I'll play the very end of it where he actually breaks down. And I think it's very, very important, especially given the era of the 1950s, late 50s, when masculinity is considered to be in crisis. I mean, the drums, especially African drums, are generally perceived as a hyper-masculine voice and a hyper-masculine activity, in the United States at least. Again, we're talking about the U.S., not, you know, I mean, in parts of Africa, the drums, there's women's drum traditions, there's men's drum traditions, and it's not necessarily a masculine thing. But in the U.S., in that period, it was. And the degree of vulnerability that's revealed in this moment of the performance is quite startling, especially for a black male jazz musician, and especially for Guy Warren, whose whole persona is built around the cool pose. So what we have here is a remarkable performance by Guy Warren, the Hepcat, crying like a baby, followed by a sublime melody played by Lawrence Brown. So this is the last part of my story. Thank you. Okay, now, Themes for African Drums got very few reviews despite Warren's enthusiastic promotion. And the silence surrounding it seems really odd to me because this is a moment where drum music is taking off everywhere. You know, Art Blakey, for example, he, in 1957, released two records, actually three, but two in particular, Drum Suite and Orgy and Rhythm, in 57. Though all of his percussionists at the time were Cuban or Puerto Rican, you know, Candido, Sabu Martinez, Ubaldo Nieto, Jose Valiente, and others. Clearly, Afro-Cuban rhythms were predominant, even if the themes were essentially West African. But the big event was the release of Olatunji's Drums of Passion in 1960, recorded in the fall and summer of 1959. Now, Olatunji originally came to the United States in 1950 to attend Morehouse College, and in 1954 went on to graduate school at NYU to pursue a PhD in public administration. He had no intention of becoming a musician. He was interested in politics and was an activist, having served as president of the All-Africa Students Union of the Americas. In New York, he occasionally played drums at student parties, though he never formally studied the instrument. In 1957, Ralph Hunter, a Radio City Music Hall's choral director, attended one of these parties in Greenwich Village and was so impressed that he promptly hired Olatunji to be a featured soloist with the Music Hall's Symphony Orchestra for a piece entitled African Drum Fantasy. The Voice of America recorded it and broadcast it overseas, and soon afterwards, Olatunji appeared on CBS TV show To Tell the Truth. Suddenly, he was in big demand. He did radio, performed all over the country, Apollo Theater, Carnegie Hall. He even did the Jack Parr Show, like overnight. When Olatunji recorded Drums of Passion, he was already considered a star. And what's interesting about the recording is that he had hired three key African-American drummers with whom he had been working, Chief Bey, Montego Joe, and Taiwo Duval. And by some accounts, they had helped Olatunji develop musically. Now consider what this means. African-American drummers serving as the main anchor for what gets billed as the first authentic African drum record, okay? Now, Drums of Passion was different from previous efforts in that it was entirely African percussion and voices, and much of it really was based on traditional rhythms. And there was no attempt at fusing jazz and African music, although Olatunji included some of his own original compositions. One was based on Christian hymns he had heard in church, Odunde Ondunde, which means Happy New Year. And he had sacred songs to, like his tribute to Shango. And like everyone at the time, he did incorporate high life as well as rhythms from Latin America. Kia Kia, Why Do You Run Away, is based on high life rhythms, and it's about why people are in such a hurry. And just hear a little snippet of this. This is Drums of Passion. Now, I'm not stopping you from dancing, you know. Just because you're in Harvard, I mean, you know, it's Harvard. You're supposed to dance, right? Now, Drums of Passion goes on to sell 5 million copies, eventually over its life, which is amazing. And I'm almost done. The sudden explosion of Olatunji was a source of frustration for Warren, especially since he was desperately trying to sell his third album, which he was calling at the time Voice of Africa. He had recorded it on his own sometime in 1959, and he'd finally gotten John Hammond interested in it, which was a big impresario and big thief of black music, not just black music, but all kinds of music. In any case, so he thought John Hammond's was interested, actually. He had sent him a dub, and he waited patiently to hear back from Hammond's. By that time, Warren had returned to Ghana. And then he gets his cable a year later from Hammond saying, quote, "Cannot contemplate recording you now. Have inherited Olatunji. Letter follows." Okay, so that was a very painful blow to Warren. And hence, that's how he ended up with Columbia Records. Desperate, Warren wrote nearly a dozen record labels trying to sell his latest recording. He struck out with Savoy Records, with Prestige, with Capitol, with RCA Victor, with Atlantic, with Riverside, and to name just a few. Decca finally accepted it and released it in 1962 under the title African Rhythms, The Exciting Sounds of Guy Warren and His Talking Drums. Now, the record was practically a one-man show, with Richard Davis on bass, Ali Shearer on vibes and marimba, and Guy doing everything else. He played all the percussion parts. By the way, he also had very negative things to say about his good friend Chief Bey, about how he fluffed up his recording, because no one really is good enough for Guy Warren, to be honest. And so he didn't hire Chief Bey again. And I listened to that record, and of course I'm no expert, but I couldn't tell where he fluffed it up. It's really powerful what Bey plays. But in any case, so Guy plays all the percussion parts, and he plays the drum kit. But what he does, and also he plays flute, piano, and vocal. But what he does on this record is that he plays more of the standard drum kit than he does African percussion instruments, but he's playing African percussion, as far as he's concerned, on the drum kit. And it's pretty clear from the responses of people who had heard the dub that the album just wasn't African enough for them, despite all the singing and chanting in Akan. His 16-minute drum suite called The Third Phase was probably seen as pretentious, especially since the opening of the drums suite, the main theme, was supposed to be based on Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. It's like da-da-da-dum, 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 you know. In any case, the kind of fusion he was trying to achieve wasn't exciting enough as far as industry people were concerned. Listen to My Anthem, which he wrote based on Psalm 150 of the Bible, and this is actually Guy Warren's own words on what this psalm is. And this is My Anthem. Let's see. As Guy Warren slowly faded off the scene, it seemed like everyone was recording with African drummers or composing themes based on African music, and some were hits. Cannonball Adderley produced a bestseller with African Waltz, recorded in 1961, and he had Olatunji on the date, as well as Ray Barreto on percussion. Herbie Mann was selling a lot of records. He had hired Olatunji too, and later hired Chief Bey. Although by this time, Chief Bey was being identified in all records as being Senegalese, which is so interesting. He got totally transformed. I mean, to the point where people write in liner notes, well, you know, Chief Bey, you know, who probably has more to do with the UN because he's from Dakar, you know? Dakar in Harlem, you know? In any case, Max Roach also brought in Olatunji for several of his albums, so he wasn't trying to get a hit. Hidden, making some radical black nationalist music. He wasn't doing that, but he had Olatunji as well. Even Ahmed Abdul-Malik had hired Montego Joe and Chief Bey for his Sounds of Africa album in 62. The most interesting development to me is Art Blakey's 1962 album, The African Beat. Now, after using all Cuban and Puerto Rican percussionists on all previous recordings where he did these African-based drum suites, by the African beat, he replaces them all with either Africans or African Americans. There are no Cuban or Puerto Rican drummers at all in this group. His band now consists, the drummers in the band now consists of Chief Bey, again identified as Senegalese, Montego Joe, Garvin Meso, James Olafolami from Nigeria, Robert Crowder, Curtis Fuller, who's playing timpani, Yusuf Latif, and Ahmed Abdul-Malik. And a Nigerian, a very important Nigerian by the name of Solomon Olori, who is clearly the musical director for the group and who wrote many of the songs. Olori came to the United States in 1958 with the goal of promoting African music and dance, and he's very, very important to the whole story, since he would go on to make his own record a year later using much the same personnel. He would also continue the drum wars in some ways by suggesting that the music that came before his album, African High Life, the one we see here, was poorly done and inauthentic. And this, I'm not going to talk about that today. It's going to be in the book. But I do want you to hear Olori's arrangement of Guy Warren's Love, the Mystery Of. We haven't heard Warren's version, but let me just hear this version. It opens with Yusuf Latif playing oboe, and then Olori and others sing. It's a really spectacular recording, and this is the last song we're going to hear. So this is Art Blakey's African Drum Suite. Yusuf Latif. Before I can close here, let me just say one thing. This afternoon, Rebecca Welch gave a brilliant presentation, and it was so great, so thank you. I was so happy to be here. Now, to conclude, I just had to say that. I meant to say it at the beginning, and I forgot. In the end, it seems clear that despite his tremendous ego, Warren was one of the main figures behind this African musical renaissance of the late 50s and early 60s. Barring evidence to the contrary, it seems that he really did introduce high life to the U.S., though apparently no one was listening, since every single musician who traveled to West Africa long after the release of Africa Speaks America Answers claims to have heard high life for the first time in West Africa, not in the United States. But Warren was just not African enough. He spoke with a slight American accent. He dressed mostly like a hipster. He always donned a hat and sunglasses, and he didn't, and this is not really how he dressed most of the time. This is him acting, you know, playing his role. Most of the time he would had like one of those brims, you know, and he just dressed very jazz-like, you know, if I could put it that way. And if we see this clip later, you'll see what I mean. He didn't have an African name, although that's very complicated because he did go by Kofi then. He went by Kofi Gnamba. People know him now as Kofi Gnamba. But he went by Kofi Gnamba among his friends, which is very interesting because there's a cut with Chief Bey, a duet between Chief Bey and Guy Warren, Kofi, and he says, Assalamualaikum Kofi. He calls him Kofi. So it's not true that he just took the name later. He actually always had that name. But he used Guy Warren in his public persona. But of course, it didn't make him African enough. He was also a very difficult person to deal with. His main problem was musical, though. He was too experimental in a world where African rhythms were associated with wild excitement, hip gyrations, and raw sexuality. He sought a fusion that was more than blues riffs over African rhythms, but one in which rhythm, harmony, melody, and instrumentation changed as a result of synthesis. He wanted to play the talking drum like a horn, and the drum set like an antumpan or bata and bell and conga put together. And he eventually did. If you ever see the movie Sankofa, the opening scene of that man playing those drums that look like a drum set, but it's all traditional drums, that's Kofi Ganaba. That's Guy Warren. It's like, oh, yeah, I've seen that guy. On the other hand, he was also too African and too black to be taken seriously by those who claim the mantle of serious music. Now, what do I mean by that? To demonstrate my point, let me just close with a little coda. In a New York Times article from November 1st, 1959, titled Shifting Tides in African Music, 59, remember this date, critic Robert Shelton quotes a prominent musicologist bemoaning the loss of traditional tribal music in favor of, quote, diluted popular music, quote, modeled after American jazz, jive, and rock and roll. And yet Shelton goes on to praise the fusion experiments of white composers. He spoke of Mieczysław Kolinsky, his piece Dahomey Suite for oboe and piano, okay, which is a brand new piece that had been released. And in Kolinsky's words, it's his attempt to, quote, blend the non-harmonic structure of West African Negro songs. There's no harmony, right? With the harmonic, polyphonic language of contemporary Western music. Okay? And Shelton was especially impressed with Fred Katz, who had just released Folk Songs for Far Out Folk on Warner Brothers, which included three, quote, African-derived numbers. And as Katz wrote in liner notes, I think it's time for jazz players and composers to extend their horizons toward other cultures rather than to Tin Pan Alley tune pickers. I know this album is a humble beginning, but it is a beginning. Now, where is he? Where are these people? They know nothing. And when it's all said and done, all of these folks, Guy Warren, Art Blakey, Ahmed Abdul-Malik, Max Roach, Chief Bey, Montego Joe, Taiwo Duval, Asadada DeVore, not to mention Catherine Dunham and Pearl Primus, and Moses Mianz, all of them are invisible. You know, all of them invisible. And in the Ellisonian sense of the word, perhaps the drum wars were yet another battle royale. Thank you. Okay, so I know you're tired of me talking, but if anyone wants to ask any questions or comments. Yes.
That piece you played, the song that had, say, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Didn't the Hazel and Sounds cop that almost exactly later on with Kimasakela?
Maybe, but let me write this down. That's possible. I don't know, and I'd have to look that up. But it's possible. At the same time, it's a phrase that seems very that common. Yeah. But that's a good. That's a really good point.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. That's interesting. I need to go back and check that out. That's a really good point. But yeah, I don't know if that's the case. But I'm gonna look that up. Yeah. Oh yes, Darlene.
Oh, thank you. It's wonderful. I know you don't like praise, so I'm not going to.
Okay.
Two things. One, whenever I think of highlight and the drum wars, I always think of dance. I don't think, and when I think of Olatunji in particular, as he toured the country, he had this fantastic dance troupe, and people, at least in Chicago, just flocked to see him. How are you going to, or are you, do you think that there's any room
Oh, a CD will be accompanied. That, yes. It definitely. And what's good about some of this music is that it's so obscure. Some of it might actually be in public domain. But if not, the estates of the people, you know, of course, would get paid directly. But a lot of the record companies, I think, many of the record companies are not in existence anymore. And I'm sure they sold the rights, except for some of the bigger labels. But I'll work that out somehow. As far as dance goes, it's a really good question. I mean, what's interesting about this moment in the late 50s is that everyone knew of high life as dance music, definitely. And one of the things I want to talk about more, which will come in the book, is that the fact that all these musicians are not just playing in jazz venues, but they're also playing in calypso bands, you know, which you don't have in the 1950s in the U.S. were a whole lot of high life bands. They do emerge in the early 60s, and most of them are playing stage shows where dancers are part of the performance as opposed to playing for dancers, or they're playing at the United Nations. And I talked yesterday about Bilal Abdulrahman, who had played with a number of high life bands, and Solomon Allori actually had one that he played with. And so a lot of jazz musicians were working there. Now, the thing about dance, again, in the US, when I talk about Ghana and Nigeria, it's a different story, but in the US, most of the venues where jazz was performed didn't allow dancing because of the dance tax. The dance tax, I mean, you know, people talk about like bebop, you know, basically completely obliterating dance because they had swifter tempos and they didn't want, but that's not true. People danced to bebop. They always did. But what they couldn't do is dance in a place where it's illegal to dance. So suddenly you get these venues that are no dancing. So the places where they were able to get gigs, like the Village Gate, for example, people might have gotten up at a table or something and danced a little bit, but it's not designed for dance. And yet, so when people played dances, it was places, the calypso places, like in Brooklyn, in the Bronx. So that's significant. And what's interesting, too, is that all these artists knew it was dance music. But when Cannibal Ali did African Waltz, he wanted to make it a danceable song. When Ahmed Abdul-Malik did African Bossa Nova, he wanted to make it danceable. Same with Randy Weston, and same with Guy Warren. But see, Guy Warren was trying to make art music. I mean, Monkeys and Butterflies, The High Life, they were meant to be dance tunes. And what I don't know, and I can't seem to figure out, is whether or not he was able to play them as dance tunes for in dance venues in Chicago. But see, he wasn't in Chicago much longer after that record was released. Now, in the African Room, dancing took place, but dancing was staged. There was some dancing going on, you know, on the stage, but also almost all this performance involved dancers. So that's why when I talk about the African Room, you gotta talk about Catherine Dunham and Pearl Primus. Both of them had performances in the African Room, and Asada Defour, who brought the dancers there. When Guy Warren did that piece, Love, Mystery Of, it was designed and written as a dance piece. Chief Bey talks about playing for dancers and what that would be, what that required, you know, in terms of being able to pay attention to what dancers are doing, rather than, he said this in this great forum that we had at NYU recently, he says a lot of drummers, particularly in that period, weren't even looking at dancers because they felt like to drum is to go into another realm, close your eyes and just jam. But he says, you know, the great drummers who understand dance and understand how linked they are has to pay attention to, and there's give and take, you know. And so I'm going to talk about that in some greater detail. But again, it's not the same kind of dance that we associate with the kind of popular dance of the swing era, because a lot of that, I don't want to say it's dying, because that's not true. What's happening is that some of these jazz artists have such a hard time just getting a gig. And the money is not there, the places are not there, the venues, and the venues that these artists know are jazz venues, you know, unless they're playing with someone else's band. But thank you, I'm gonna actually look into that more. Yes.
Mm-hmm. In their culture space.
Right. Okay, well, it's two things. One is that Guy actually did have training in the lineage, but he had two kinds of training. He had training in the high life bands, in that mutant popular music, playing a drum set, but he also had training in particularly the talking drum. He worked with people in Ghana. This is what he says. So there's that, and yet he dispensed with a lot of his training, you know, which what a lot of artists do. You know, you learn a certain way, and he tries to change the way he did it. In the case of Olatunji, this is a very interesting story. I can't speak to all the times he performed in West Africa, but there's one particular time that we know about, and that is when he traveled to West Africa with the American Society of African Culture in 1961. It was the trip that I talked about yesterday with Randy Weston and Nina Simone went and Odetta. He got terrible, terrible reviews in the press. They made fun of him. They said, look at this man, Olatunji, trying to play talking drum. He doesn't know what he's doing. Now, it's tricky because, again, you know, to be able to understand the criticism is to sort of know that not everyone in Nigeria or Ghana or anywhere knows what drummers do. In other words, knows all the intricacies. That's in any culture. That's in any culture. So what I don't know is, like, the journalist who wrote that, what does the journalist music critic know about what's happening on stage? On the other hand, it's coming in Nigeria and is very popular, and he apparently got a very bad reaction to his performance from the people of Nigeria. Now, again, these things have to be so historicized because, you know, and this is why ethnomusicology is so important for being able to identify particular rhythms and what's a sharp performance versus what is a weak performance. However, the means of evaluation change over time, you see? So I wouldn't be surprised if in 1961, what people are doing on stage for an audience that wants to swing is not interested in something that may actually be really traditional. But see, we don't know that unless we actually kind of explore what's going on. And again, not everyone really has the same way of understanding, same means of understanding, I think, in every society, the people who are really good at this. And this is one of the things that's disturbing about the way that African-American, antebellum African-American culture gets written about. The assumption is that, you know, everyone who's actually doing the ring shout and everyone who's doing dances in a particular context, they all have the same abilities. This is just a general assumption that everyone has the same, everyone who plays the violin, the fiddle, I'm sorry. Everyone plays the fiddle, plays the banjo, but it's not true. There were great banjo players and terrible ones. There were terrible musicians of antebellum black America who just couldn't play, couldn't hear. Some people couldn't dance. And they said, sit your ass down. I mean, that's how it was. But see, we sometimes end up fetishizing the tradition, the folk, so all the folk know the means. And so that's the thing, and that's why your question is so important, is that I think there's many levels of evaluation. And with Olatunji, my feeling is, and again, I need to investigate this more, and I should also say that I'm not going to take this story much further than the early 60s, because I think other things happen later that are interesting, but they're part of another story. But Olatunji, I think, gets better and better and better and better to the point where he's just an outstanding drummer, doing amazing stuff, and also doing stuff that wasn't in the tradition. He would tell Taiwo Duval and Chief Bey to play this rhythm, but the rhythm is not really tied to Nigeria. It may be something that he had heard some of the Afro-Cuban drummers do and incorporate that in. But, I mean, to some ears, it doesn't really matter. Well, it's presented, I think, by the press as Nigerian music. I'm not sure if Olatunji tried to present it all as Nigerian music. And that's the thing. He wasn't as vocal about exactly what he was trying to do. And I think that the same with Guy Warren. Guy Warren never tried to present his stuff as traditional. He tried to present his stuff as a fusion and as a mixture and as his own creation. You know, and yet he would also talk about where he get his ideas. Like one particular piece he did was based entirely on the rhythms of pygmies in Congo. These Congolese rhythms, and he's not from the Congo. He just take and pick and choose. But the same thing with High Life. I mean, High Life is seen as West African music, but then they're incorporating Marabi in you know, African jive, which is a South African form. You see, so it's like all that stuff is coming together, and it's very Pan-African, it's very open and loose. But again, I'm not an expert on African music, and I'm not pretending to be, just so you know. Don't attack me for not being one. But I think that one of the things that's so sad about the way in which music gets written about, so-called traditional music, is that traditional music is always treated as fixed and frozen in time. But what they're doing in 1840 is not what they're doing in 1890. I mean, things are changing, people are coming up with ideas, and also, this is a musical form in which improvisation is everything. You know, of course, you have to fit within certain kinds of frameworks. Of course, you got to play together, and you're trained to do that. But there's also moments when you step out and produce something that no one's heard before, and that's what's celebrated, that ability to do that. And that's one of the things that came over on the ships. Not so much the actual specific bodies of drums or particular instruments alone, is a philosophical concept of what music is, you know. So I know Evelyn had your hand up.
I did. I'm not an is defined as the more authentic over a Ghanaian sound or a Rwandan sound for whatever reason. But that as the wave moves forward, the person who could be most cosmopolitan with all that sound actually gets it defined as authentic. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, no, it makes perfect sense. The only problem with Olatunji, though, is that what he ends up playing really is, from the very beginning, a hybrid. You know, I mean, he's from Nigeria, and he tells that story. And I think that, again, it's a discourse around Olatunji that's much more powerful than what he actually plays. I'm not saying what he plays is interesting and powerful, but he has a story. There's a narrative around him, and there's a narrative around Guy Warren, but Guy Warren's narrative is much more about him being a modern subject. Olatunji is a modern subject too, though. A PhD candidate in public administration. I mean, that's a very modern subject. But he's also someone who, and someone who can't even claim a musical history. None of the writings on Olatunji tell his musical history, except for the fact that he danced. He was a dancer in Nigeria as a young person. And he grew up in a Christian, very Christian tradition. You know, African Orthodox kind of Christian tradition. And that Christianity comes out in his music. But he's bringing on other drummers who are playing stuff from all over the continent. And see, this is a key thing, is that when you listen to Olatunji's music, it's not just Olatunji playing. It's Chief Bey playing, it's Taiwo Duval playing, it's Montego Joe playing, and others who are playing. Yeah, it sounds different only because of the instrumentation. It's only that. In other words, that in instrumentation, also the way it's arranged. So, for example, Olatunji, and I think I mentioned this, Olatunji made this record solely of percussion and voices. So there's no bass, there's no piano, there's nothing else. And there's some songs that Guy Warren has is strictly percussion. But they have different agendas. So Olatunji... and Olatunji is also playing with other people. And that's the other thing which is interesting. On the one hand, he's playing with Herbie Mann and playing with Cannonball Adderley and playing with Max Roach. And so he'd already pretty much made it. But when he makes Drums of Passion, people liked it because it's a drum bank, you know, it's an ensemble that sounds very traditional. And yet, if you break down rhythmically what's happening, it's everywhere. And yet, there's sometimes when Guy Warren is playing something that's really traditional, you know, and he said, this is a con. This is where this rhythm comes from, and this is what I'm doing. But the mere fact that he may add a trumpet would suddenly make it not work, as far as people's ears are concerned. The other thing is that it's not even just where it comes from, but it's the question of how much excitement it generates. You see, not all West African musics produce that kind of excitement. They're ballads. They're you know, there's a whole tradition of choral music. You know, there's all kinds of traditions of music. There's music for everything, for every act. And it's amazing that it just so happens that the beautiful music that Olatunji makes in Drums of Passion goes well with the perception of what drumming is. So if I were to play, for example, some of the recordings of Thurston Knudsen on primitive percussion, it would sound closer to Olatunji, see, than it would to Guy Warren. And again, it's like, in that context, American culture, including the jazz musicians, not all of them, but some of them, are more interested in finding something that they see as authentic and untouched than they are finding an African, no matter where they're from, who is actually trying to produce something new, but using tradition to do it, you see? And that's the amazing thing. I mean, Guy Warren could have come here and just been a straight ahead drummer. There's no reason why he didn't. No, but he said, no, I want to do something new. I want to take this talking drum and make it a jazz instrument. And he did it. In fact, to this day, I mean, there's all kinds of people play talking drum just like that. Just like that. They're playing as like it's supposed to be a tonal instrument, but playing it with chord progressions and trying to play in relationship to those progressions. People do that stuff, and Guy Warren started that, you know. But he just gets wiped off. And I think your point is really, really important. That is, it still comes down to how is authenticity defined? It comes down to, you know, what does a real African do? And what I'm trying to argue here is that the ears were already prepared by the ethnographic recordings, prepared even by the... In fact, let me just want to say one thing. I'm talking too much. But Asadada Defour gets roundly criticized by some critics for his music and dance being too elitist and not being authentic either. And there's a really interesting moment in 1959 where his dancers perform with the Jazz Modes, which is Charlie Rouse and Julius Watkins' band, in Carnegie Hall. And the critic is going on and on about how, you know, oh, you know, it was so elitist, nothing really African there, and then worse than that, all Rouse and Watkins did was just jam. You know, they didn't do anything sort of unique and in conversation with the dancers, which may be true. But the fact of the matter is that the presumption is that there's nothing really authentically African about what's going on stage, you know, because it doesn't look that way. And meanwhile, all these Africans are making this great music in Ghana, in Nigeria, and everywhere. We haven't talked about the conga. We haven't talked about all this wonderful, powerful music with electric guitars, you know, with drum kits. With all kinds of instruments, and it's being seen as watered down versions of what's real, you know. So, I guess I could yes, Alice. Now going back.
On that whole issue about things being designated as authentic, who's in a position to designate what's authentic? You know, a few times you brought up the UN as this venue for this music, as well as then on the other hand you have the African room, and then of course you have these albums. So do you see differences between them? I mean, was the UN project, or were there, or do you see differences as well among those who are taking kind of an anthropological interest in this as opposed to a commercial interest in this, in the ways they operate to designate what's authentic, what's not?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's some people taking an anthropological, some people taking an entertainment, and the thing is that they come together, they cross over. What's interesting about the UN is that there's a political interest as well in the promotion of this music, because it's also, I mean, you think about the importance, for example, again, this is beyond my project, but I may end up talking about it. Particularly the World's Fair in New York in 1964, and what it meant for the National Ballet of Guinea to perform, or the Watusi dancers. That was a huge, huge deal. And the way it was framed for this audience, because what they're trying to do is that we're modern Africa. This is what Africa looks like. And the Ballet of Guinea was supposed to be a kind of interesting fusion of tradition, but also modernity. You know, and people talked about how beautiful it was and what it meant. And these are highly trained dancers. But also people are like, well, they're highly trained dancers. Oh, man, that's like not the real thing. When, of course, dancers who are always highly trained, you know, it's not, this is, they're not trying to sort of take a scene from the Kaban Bamboo Club and sort of open up the windows and say, see these people dancing the high life. You know, that's different from being a highly trained dancer. The other thing about the UN, which I didn't even mention, which is so interesting, is that the first African General Secretary of the UN, Saxon Kwesi, God, what is his name? Saki, Quezon Saki. I think it's Quezon Saki is his last name. I think that's right, or Saki Quezon. He's so much like Kofi. Right. I'm sorry. My brain is all messed up. But they're so similar in that they both are jazz lovers. And this was in the 1950s. I guess it's 59 or 60 was when he became general secretary. Both are jazz lovers, you know. Both play the drums. You know, both like try to sit in with musicians. And both were big promoters of jazz. Saki Quezon, or Quezon Saki, he was the chair of a Central Park jazz festival, you know, in, I guess it was 1960, you see. And so there are also people who have an interest in the music and jazz, in American jazz and other manifestations of it, but also have an interest in promoting forms of African culture for diplomatic purposes. So their interest kind of cuts across. That's a really good question. I know I could take just a couple more questions, because I know I'm going to be yelled at for the... Yes?
Hi. Thanks a lot for your presentation. I think it's been really informative. I know you're focusing on this particular era, but I was wondering if you had any information on the influence of Gadwar on Guinean music subsequently. I was working with a studio in Accra, the suburb, with kids who are doing primarily Kiplak, which is like the name of fusion of Kiplak, and their pictures of Gadwar all over.
Really? That's a good question. I don't really know about the contemporary music scene, but he's always had a big impact in Ghana. I mean, even from the late 40s, from the time he was a teenager, it's amazing how much respect he got, and also how much he was a source of controversy. I mean, in the Accra Daily Times and these publications, there'll be all these articles debating his performances. So even returning back to Ghana must have been a big deal. I do know that he continued to make records through the 60s and 70s, and some of those records were even more experimental than what we have here. The other thing that I have one of his records, I think, it's a compilation recording from about 1968 to the mid to late 70s, and they're all multi-instrumentalist pieces, and a lot of them are pieces where it's totally him. There's no one else. He plays piano, he plays rhythm, he plays flute, he does his voice thing. It's like he is the one-man band, all overdub pieces. And I don't know how well those records did, but he continued to make this music. You know, it's a tragedy that he kind of dropped out of sight in the U.S. scene, but I'm sure in Ghana he must be a giant. And I don't think it's an accident when Haile Gerima made Sankofa that he wanted to open with Kofi Ghanaba. I mean, when he went there to make those scenes, everyone was saying Kofi's the one. On the other hand, I just have to say this, he's come back to the U.S. and played, and I heard really interesting stories. Neil Clark, who the person I mentioned who's writing this book, who's a fantastic percussionist for Randy Weston, just absolutely brilliant. He tells a story about when Kofi comes back to the U.S. and he plays with them in Washington Square Park, and that Kofi basically stole the show. Like, what he did was he basically bum-rushed and just took over, and people were upset with him to this day, and just, like, did his whole thing, and, like, he didn't care what anyone else was doing. It's like, this is me. And that's how they remember him, as someone with this huge ego who's just a giant. And so it's interesting that, I mean, you could say that about a lot of artists, actually, but it's interesting that that's how he's remembered here, even in terms of his recent performances, you see. It's interesting to see what it means in Ghana, you know, his presence in Ghana. But that's a really good question. I guess I could take one more. Oh, Maxine. Oh, this is the last question. Okay. Oh, Nat Shapiro was the person. Yeah, he was the one. And I'm amazed and I knew that. Anyway, thank you so much for staying. Thank you.